Col tuo nome. Come dai?
Good evening. Welcome to our clinical pharmacology session. I hope the audio and the video is clear. I'm your pharmacology educator, Dr. Arpit. So I can see Habib, Dominic, Mahesh. Good evening to all of you. I hope the audio and the video quality is appropriate. Give me a thumbs up if the audio video quality is appropriate. Okay. So let's crack the PG examinations with NEET PG, the best tool, the best app in the market to help you crack NEET PG as well as the FMG examinations. A brief about myself before we go on to the topic. I'm your pharmacology educator, Dr. Arpit Agarwal, MD in pharmacology. I bring with myself over 10 years experience in teaching students across the country. Over all these years, I have mentored more than 50,000 students for PPG as well as for FMG examinations. If you have not yet downloaded the Unacademy app, please download the app right away. The best app to help you crack NEET PG. So you cannot afford to be not downloading the Unacademy. Download it right away. Unacademy offers you to suit your needs two kind of subscription, the plus subscription as well as the iconic subscription. So you can choose from the two subscriptions, the plus as well as the iconic. The plus subscription brings you unlimited live classes by the top educators of the country, unlimited live tests and quizzes and various batch courses to meet your needs. With the iconic subscription, you will get the best of both Prep Ladder as well as the Unacademy. With Unacademy, you will grab unlimited live classes, live tests. With Prep Ladder subscription, you would also require or also receive the recorded video lectures of the Prep Ladder, handwritten notes along with the question bank. So it gives you twin advantages, the iconic subscription. Using the code Dr. Arpit Agarwal will give you an instant 10% discount on your subscription fee. If you go for iconic subscription, as you can see in this particular slide, you can avail a 12 month, 18 month, 24 or 36 month course. And using the code Dr. Arpit Agarwal will give you an instant 10% discount. Similarly, if you decide to opt for the plus course, if you decide to opt for the unlimited Unacademy live classes, you can again use the code Dr. Arpit Agarwal and it gives you a 10% discount on your total subscription fee. The plus course can be availed for as low as 1 month to as high as 36 months depending on your needs. So Unacademy brings you the freedom to choose. Unacademy brings you the freedom to choose. Welcome Anjana, welcome Mahesh, Dominic, Habib. I hope everybody can see it clearly and hear me clearly. Give me a thumbs up if the audio video quality is appropriate. Unacademy brings you the best of educators across the country to help you track NEET PG. And it offers the various courses, batch courses to suit your needs, whether you are a NEET PG 2021 aspirant or an FMG 2021 or you are going to prepare for the next 2022. So we have the top educators with unlimited live classes and new batches every week. Now this is the schedule for this particular week on our favorite Let's Crack NEET PG YouTube channel. I am Dr. Arpit bringing you pharmacology live. So at 6 p.m. on 22nd, 23rd and 24th February, you will have the clinical pharmacology MCQs part 1, 2 and 3. Okay, and at 8 p.m. you will find another important topic being discussed, that is side effects of drugs part 1, part 2 and part 3. So block your calendars and be ready. Okay, starting with the first question on your screen. Now we have a 64 year old female with a history of MI and CHF. She is on therapy with ACE inhibitor, beta blocker and statins along with aspirin. So she is suffering from myocardial infarction, she is suffering from congestive heart failure, receiving ACE inhibitor, beta blocker, aspirin. She comes to emergency room, ER is emergency room, with severe dyspnea, pink frothy sputum and diaphoresis. So what are these symptoms suggestive of? Pink frothy sputum, dyspnea, severe dyspnea and diaphoresis. She is unable to breathe, she is having pink frothy sputum and looks diaphoretic. On examination, she has cyanosis and rails. Some people call them bronchi, crepitations, rails. These are auscultatory sounds. They are present all over lung fields. The chest x-ray reveals the butterfly pattern, characteristic butterfly pattern of alveolar edema. What would be the best drug? What would be the best drug? So what is this patient? We have to first understand what is the condition that has developed. So we have a known case of congestive heart failure. You see, it is a known case of congestive heart failure. Now this case is presenting with severe dyspnea. This case is presenting in emergency with dyspnea, bilateral rales, cyanosis. So what has happened? This patient has gone into acute pulmonary edema. That is what we can say, that due to left ventricular failure, the lady has gone into acute pulmonary edema, and all these symptoms are suggestive of acute pulmonary edema: sudden onset of severe dyspnea, bilateral rales, and cyanosis along with the butterfly pattern of alveolar edema. So this lady has developed acute pulmonary edema subsequent to left ventricular failure, and we need to provide immediate treatment. So what would be the drug of choice? IV dobutamine, IV digoxin, IV furosemide, or IV milrinone? Yes, everyone. What is the best drug in your opinion to treat this particular patient? What is the best drug out of IV dobutamine, digoxin, furosemide, milrinone? What is the best drug that should be given for this particular patient? Yes, Anjana. MM has given the answer. Others, Mahesh, everybody. Anjana also says C, and that is correct. We have to give IV furosemide is considered drug of choice for acute pulmonary edema. So that is the drug of choice. Now what two things that we want to understand here are these. So look at this particular case. This is a case of acute left ventricular failure developing into pulmonary edema. Okay, patient has gone into decompensated or acute LVF developing into pulmonary edema. First of all, you have to give this patient furosemide. Now the question that is asked, what is the mechanism of furosemide in this particular case? What is the mechanism of furosemide? Can you tell me? What is the mechanism? How does furosemide offer relief in this particular case? That is the question which is asked, very commonly asked. Normally furosemide acts as a diuretic. Is the same mechanism going to apply here, or there is some other mechanism? Can you tell me the same mechanism or some other mechanism is going to apply here in this particular case? So please remember, most of the students will think of diuresis, but that is not the main mechanism. The main mechanism is the drug will cause rapid but transient venodilation. That is the main mechanism in this case, rapid venodilation. And when there is rapid venodilation, the blood will move from pulmonary system to systemic circulation. So redistribution of blood will occur from the lung to the lower veins, from the pulmonary circulation to the systemic circulation, because veins in lower limbs will dilate, the blood will pool into lower limbs, and the lungs will not have enough blood to cause edema. So rapid venodilation leading to redistribution of blood to the lower veins is the main mechanism, and that is followed by diuresis. That is the second mechanism. So main mechanism is this. This would cause rapid relief. Immediate relief will come within minutes, even before diuresis starts. So that is what you need to remember. Furosemide is the drug of choice, and here the main mechanism is rapid venodilation. In all other cases, furosemide relieves edema by causing diuresis, but here the main mechanism is shifting of fluid from pulmonary to systemic circulation. So furosemide will be the drug given. Focus on these symptoms and focus on the history. CHF patient coming with pink frothy sputum, diaphoresis, severe dyspnea, rales, acute pulmonary edema. Next question on your screen. We have a 59-year-old male who presents with sudden onset of chest pain. ECG showed peaked T waves, ST segment elevation. ST segment elevation, we know what this condition is now, and Q waves. He is given all the drugs listed below for immediate relief and long-term prevention. Which drug provides immediate relief but does not reduce against the long-term risk of sudden death? Okay, which drug will provide? First of all, what is this patient suffering from? What is this patient suffering from? We have a case of chest pain and ST elevation. So diagnosis should be pretty straightforward and clear. Chest pain with ECG showing ST segment elevation. We are looking at an ST elevated MI. ST MI is what patient has developed. ST segment elevation, patient has ST MI along with Q waves. So first of all, we should know what all we would give this particular patient. What all treatment would be given? Before we go to any other thing, we should know what all things will be given for this particular case. So let me write on the next slide what all will be given in a case of acute MI. Number one thing, you will use oxygen if the SpO2 is less than 90%, then give the patient oxygen inhalation. If it is already more than 90%, there is no need. Second, you will give this patient aspirin. Aspirin 325 milligram stat. Chewable aspirin, you will put in his mouth, ask him to chew and spread over the buccal mucosa. 325 milligram stat tablet will be put into his mouth. Then you will also start what we call as anti-ischemic treatment. Now please remember, in anti-ischemic treatment, three things will be given for this particular patient. One is obviously nitroglycerin, sublingual tablet of nitroglycerin you will start. You will also give morphine. Do not forget morphine. Morphine is needed to decrease the pain and sympathetic activity also. And also you will give beta blocker. Beta blocker will also be used. So that will be given anti-ischemic treatment. Then you will put the patient on anticoagulant. You will start anticoagulant. It can be low molecular weight heparin or unfractionated heparin, but anticoagulant is given. And finally comes the definitive treatment. Definitive treatment is percutaneous intervention, PCI, percutaneous intervention, that is angioplasty or coronary artery bypass. Percutaneous intervention is the definitive treatment. Here you have to see if time to perform PCI is less than 2 hours. Perform the PCI, percutaneous intervention, you do it. So if cath lab is available, cardiologist is available, you do the percutaneous intervention. But please remember, if time that it is going to take to perform percutaneous intervention is more than two hours, then you will give thrombolytics. So that is the treatment, acute treatment of MI. Okay, you have acute MI, you will give all these things, you will manage with this drug treatment. Now at discharge, once the patient is stabilized, at discharge, you see now this patient will take few drugs lifelong. He will take lifelong antiplatelet therapy. Mostly it is aspirin, but it may be combined with clopidogrel also, dual antiplatelet therapy. He will take lifelong statins. He can be put on ACE inhibitors, that would depend on certain conditions, and also beta blockers. So ACE inhibitors, beta blockers generally are prescribed, but there might be some contraindications. We'll have to see patient-wise. Patient to patient, it may change. So you see, you have to be very clear what is given in acute MI and what is given at discharge. Okay, so nitroglycerin SOS might be given, but it is not something that patient will take regularly after discharge. So that is what you need to do. Now, what is question asking? In this background, come to the question. Question is asking that we have a patient of acute MI with ST elevation. He is given all the drugs listed below. Now, which of these drugs provides immediate relief but does not reduce his chance of dying a sudden death? Answer is nitroglycerin. Nitroglycerin, now I hope you will understand, will provide immediate relief, that is anti-ischemic therapy, but it does not reduce risk of long-term sudden death. So it is an immediate symptomatic relief that will come, but other drugs that you see, antiplatelet drug, statins, ACE inhibitors, beta blockers, okay? Yes, ACE inhibitors, captopril, statins, antiplatelet and beta blocker, they reduce the long-term death chances, but nitroglycerin and morphine that you are giving initially will not reduce long-term mortality. So that is what we want to know. So please remember that acute MI treatment and the at discharge treatment. Moving to the next question. We have now a 60-year-old male with history of angina and hypertension. He is on enalapril, atenolol, atorvastatin and aspirin. He was started on drug X about a month back. He now presents with fatigue, muscle pain and red urine. Serum creatinine kinase is raised. All of the following could be drug X except. Very, very important question. Very, very important question. It comes almost every year nowadays. Very important question comes almost every year nowadays. And you should be able to tell me the answer. You should be able to tell me the correct answer. I expect correct answers from all of you. So we have a case. We have a case of angina hypertension, taking many drugs, statins. One of the many drugs that he is taking is statin. Now he was started on some drug X. He was started on drug X and now he is presenting with symptoms like fatigue, muscle pain and red urine. Creatine kinase is raised. What is your diagnosis? Avinash says myoglobin urea. What about others? Anjana? Habib? MM? What about others? What is this patient develops? He is coming with red urine. Red urine, fatigue, increase in creatine kinase. Creatine kinase should be self-explanatory. The patient has developed rhabdomyolysis leading to myoglobin urea. That is what this patient has developed. And why this patient has developed? Because drug X is some drug that has reduced statin metabolism. So let's look at the explanation. What could be drug X except? The question is asking drug X except. Let's look at the explanation. It is very, very simple. If you look at the explanation, try and understand. It is very, very simple. What is this? You see statins. Please try to understand, statins decrease cholesterol synthesis. That is their role. That is their mechanism. Now, cholesterol is needed for muscles. Muscles have membranes. These membranes are made up of cholesterol, lipids. So when decrease in cholesterol occurs, muscles are affected, and one of the side effects of statins is myopathy. So that is a known side effect of statin. Myopathy generally will result only in fatigue. Generally, it is very mild. Patient will complain of mild fatigue. But if we have increased level of statins, then what can happen? There can be excessive muscle damage, excessive myopathy, and that can cause the situation presented in the question. So what we are looking for any situation, any condition that decreases statin metabolism will increase statin level and cause excessive myopathy. It could be old age, some physiological. It could be female sex. It could be hypothyroidism, or it could be some drugs. So there are many conditions which can lead to decrease in statin metabolism. and increase the level of statin leading to myopathy. That is what we want to know. In question, we are asked predominantly about drugs, but there are other conditions also. Old age, female sex, hypothyroidism, even liver failure. So let's look at the drugs. Which drugs? So these are the important drugs that you should know. Statins are metabolized by CYP3A4, most of the statins. So inhibitors of CYP3A4 like macrolides, those drugs that will inhibit CYP3A4, erythro and clarithro, ketoconazole, ritonavir, these are three most commonly given examples, erythromycin and clarithromycin. In azoles, mostly you are given ketoconazole. In protease inhibitor, it is mostly ritonavir. These are three important drugs which are given. Besides that, amiodarone and warfarin are also sometimes mentioned. They all drugs will decrease CYP3A4 activity and lead to rhabdomyolysis. So that is what we want to remember. Statins cause myopathy. That is a known side effect. Now statins, in other language, if I tell you, are metabolized by CYP3A4. So if you give any drug that inhibits this enzyme, CYP3A4, if you give any drug that inhibits CYP3A4, level of statin will go up and they will cause myopathy. They will cause more myopathy that will cause more muscle damage resulting in rhabdomyolysis. So all we are trying to remember are important inhibitors of CYP3A4, which I have just noted. Remember first 2 and 3. They are more important, more commonly asked in MCQ. So with this background, we can go to the question. So warfarin increases statin metabolism. It is written here. And so does amiodarone. And so does erythromycin. So which drug cannot be drug X? Answer is metformin. Metformin cannot be drug X because metformin has no such enzyme inhibition action. Enzyme inhibition action is not present in metformin, so this drug cannot be metformin. That is what is the answer. So warfarin, amiodarone, erythromycin, they are likely to result in severe myopathy due to statins. Okay. Next, we have an 80-year-old woman. Anjana, I think now it should be clear. Still not, please let me know. 80-year-old woman is admitted with a 3-day history of abdominal pain and vomiting. We have a 3-day history of abdominal pain and vomiting. Her last passage of bowel was 6 days ago. 6 days ago, she passed her motion. CT scan shows an obstructing mass in colon. So if we simply draw a diagram of her intestine, then what CT scan has shown is that there is a, let's say, obstruction here, obstructing mass in the colon. That is what is shown. She has a history of long QT syndrome. So that is the history given, which antiemetic will be most appropriate. So she has come for vomiting. So we are trying to give antiemetic. Which antiemetic will be most appropriate? Now you tell me. We have a case presenting with vomiting. We want to treat the vomiting. That is our aim. We have a history of colon mass obstruction in colon. And we have a history of long QT interval. These are the two important points given. Which antiemetic out of these, cyclizine, metoclopramide, domperidone, ondansetron, which of them will you use? Tell me which of them will you prefer? Which of these will you prefer? Yes, anyone? Cyclizine, metoclopramide, domperidone, ondansetron. Which of them will you prefer? So let's see it in this particular manner. Let's look at the individual properties of these drugs. Metoclopramide and domperidone. Both these drugs are what we call as prokinetic drugs. Prokinetic drugs, by blocking D2 receptors in GIT, D2 blockade, they cause prokinesis. That means increase in GI motility. But there is a mass downstream. Obstructing mass is given. So if we increase the motility, but there is a mass downstream, there can be chances of rupture of intestine because mass will not allow contents to move forward. There is a definite organic blockade. So these drugs are contraindicated if there is an organic obstruction. If there is an organic obstruction that like a mass, then you do not give. There is no point in increasing motility to in a case where there is an organic obstruction like a tumor downstream. So these two drugs are out. Then we come to ondansetron. Ondansetron is a very good antiemetic. It is not a prokinetic. It is 5-HT3 blocker. It has very little side effects, no major problem, but the only problem it has is it can increase QT interval. So obviously, if the drug can increase QT interval, you would like to avoid in which patients? In patients who already have a history of QT interval. So these three drugs cannot be given in this case. Then what is left? If these three, it is clear why these three drugs are not given. Metoclopramide, domperidone. They increase motility, but there is an obstruction downstream. We cannot increase motility in such cases. They are out. Ondansetron has side effect of increasing QT. It is out. So what is left? What is left in this case? In this case, what is left as the answer is cyclizine. Cyclizine is an antihistaminic, not very commonly used, but may be used as antiemetic, like in this case. Like in this case. So what we learned in this particular question, ondansetron side effect. Ondansetron side effect is increasing QT interval and metoclopramide, domperidone, you avoid an organic obstruction. If there is an organic obstruction in the intestine, do not increase the motility. So that is what is the clinical, the beauty of clinical scenario-based question. You have to know in which patient, which drug will be more effective. Okay, so drug of choice questions are more or less theoretical questions. Clinical scenario, even the best antiemetic like ondansetron may not be relevant in a particular case. So that is the beauty of clinical scenario-based question. Next questions. A 19-year-old woman has a history of asthma for 10 years. Okay, she is taking daily inhalations of budesonide and formoterol. Very good. Which is correct treatment, I think. Budesonide is inhaled corticosteroids and formoterol is a good long-acting broncho beta-2 agonist, bronchodilator. So ICS plus LABA is a good combination, the standard combination for maintenance therapy of asthma. She presents with acute onset of dyspnea and wheezing. So she has developed acute attack or acute worsening or exacerbation. Which of the following will be the best? So this is based on the latest, what we call as the Global Initiative for Asthma or GINA Guidelines 2020, latest GINA Guidelines 2020, and which are treatment guidelines for asthma. So those of you who have attended some of my previous classes or have read this topic in medicine will be able to answer. Avinash says D, and D is the correct answer. D is the correct answer. So nowadays, what the guidelines are saying, this is the change from earlier. From earlier, what is the change? If you have an acute attack of asthma, then previously salbutamol SOS was the preferred answer. A would have been the answer earlier. But now, if you have an acute attack, as per the latest guidelines, you take the inhaler of budesonide, bud plus formoterol. So that is even for acute attack nowadays. This was earlier. So that is what you want to remember, that now if you have an acute attack, the best treatment is combination of budesonide plus formoterol. And this is specially true. Please remember, this is told specially for patients. We can write it specially for patients, especially for those patients who are already on this inhaler, budesonide plus formoterol. Who are already on this inhaler, it is specially good for them. So instead of salbutamol alone, only SABA, take budesonide, ICS and formoterol. The point that we need to remember here is formoterol is both long acting, so it can be used for daily maintenance, but formoterol is also quick in onset. It is also quick onset, so it can also be used for acute attack, and that is the property that has been utilized in this particular guideline. So if your patient is already taking budesonide and formoterol daily, if such a patient develops acute worsening, give extra inhalation of the same inhaler. Give extra inhalation of the same inhaler. Do not, there is no need to take extra salbutamol. That is what is latest GINA guideline. Latest GINA guideline. So that is all we had for today's class. That is all we had for today's class. I hope you enjoyed the few clinical scenario-based questions that I have discussed with you. I'll see you again. I'll see you again at 8 p.m. with important side effects of drugs part one on your favorite YouTube channel. Let's crack NEET PG. Let's crack NEET PG. So we have discussed few questions, few important questions today, clinical scenario. We'll continue on the series on tomorrow and day after. Tomorrow and day after. So that's all from my side in this session. Hope you enjoyed the session. Use the code Dr. Arpit Agrawal to subscribe to an academy and get a 10% discount. If you have not subscribed the channel, do it now and hit the bell icon. Thank you all, and I wish that you are preparing well, and together we will crack NEET.